And it should be in a voice actor.
They had said actually body of work, and I thought they said, like, describe
I
your
actually
body.
Thought they yeah. did too. But I saw on Twitter, did you do a role where you actually had to gain weight?
Yeah, that's really funny you mentioned that. I was in a movie called Lumberjack Man.
Yeah.
And they actually asked me if I could, like, pork up for the movie, which I found was really easy to do. And gaining weight, I found, is so much easier than losing weight.
Yeah.
But anyway, in answer to your earlier question, like, yes, I am a genius. Yeah. So thank you for asking. That was really nice. And I know that you... I hope I was able to sign everything. I mean, 25 items is a lot, but I mean, whatever for you. You seem to be pretty cool.
Oh, thank you.
And how's your stomach? Are you feeling better? I know you're really nervous about doing this.
Yeah, you know, I just threw up a couple of times before.
Yeah, I saw it, but I wasn't.
I saw it before.
I know. But I'm sure that
black
hopefully
from the dog food.
Yeah, they won't see that on camera, hopefully. So
yeah.
It is starting to smell. So when is this thing starting?
Sly, when are we starting? Oh, we're live.
Hello.
Hey.
Hi, how's it going?
Hey, everyone. Thanks for joining our Madman live stream at Supernova Perth. And my name's Jess, and I work at Madman, and I'm joined here by the lovely Christopher Sabat.
I'm the lovely Christopher Sabat. The unattractive Christopher Sabat couldn't make it this evening.
And you may know him from his work as the voice of Vegeta, Zoro from One Piece. A personal favorite of mine, Kuwabara from
Yu Hakusho,
Armstrong from Full Metal Alchemist, and more recently, All Might from My Hero Academia. Yes. Demia? The Americans pronounce it differently to how we do. So.
Yeah, well, we're not
we just
that
cover
smart.
Both.
Yeah.
thank you so much for joining us. How has your trip to Australia been so far?
It's great. It's great. Like, the last time I was in Perth was maybe, I feel like it was about 5 years ago. And I remember it being a great weekend. I actually have the same handler that I had. We call them handlers. I guess you guys call them guest relations people. No, volleys.
Ah, right? Yeah.
I have the same volley that I had 5 years ago. I requested her. Her name's Kelly Patterson. And she was so cool to me because 5 years ago, you know, it wasn't actually Supernova. I think it was a different convention. It might have been maybe Oz Comic Con or something.
Oh, yeah.
She helped me at that con, and at that time, I didn't know anybody really, so she was really cool, and she showed me Fremantle, and she showed me some of the other breweries around town. She was very cool. She even took me to the Apple Store, so
oh,
I requested
nice.
Her this time, and it's good to see her again. It's good to see everybody.
What's your favorite place in, actually, not just Perth, but in Australia?
Well, there's something about just walking around in downtown Sydney that I love so much, and it's not because I like Sydney for any reason over any other place, but, oh, wait, that didn't make sense. It is early, guys, and we had our VIP party last night, so bear with me. There's something special about Sydney because I lived in Killarney Heights, which is a suburb north of Sydney. Mm-hmm. I went to high school there at St. Pius X College in Chatswood. And later I went to Killarney Heights High School. And so on my weekends, my parents, you know, we were from America, obviously, and it was a culture shock for us. And the coolest thing is that I used to be able to take the trains and the buses anywhere, which is not something you can do in Dallas, Texas or Houston, Texas. We don't have like a public transportation system. So that was new to me. So all the time, any chance I got, even sometimes when I was supposed to be in school, I would take the trains into downtown Sydney and I'd exit the train at the Queen Victoria Building and I would wander around the kind of the Pitt Street area. And so that still has a lot of like strong memories for me. So I always try and make, you know, I always try and make the Queen Victoria Building in Sydney like my home base of tourism.
Yeah. And I mentioned a couple of the characters that you voiced. What are some of your favorites and which ones are you most proud of?
The characters that stick with me the most are, of course, the Dragon Ball characters because I've played them the longest. I mean, I've been voicing Vegeta for 17 years now. It's been a long time. And let's see. But some of my other favorite roles, one of my favorite roles to actually play, even though it might not be my favorite show, because I question how funny the show is versus how vulgar it is. It's called Panty and Stocking featuring Gardevoir.
Yes. Yep.
That show is so shocking and looks so cool. Like, it has great animation and has the best collection of dirty words in it you could ever possibly find. But sometimes I wonder if that show's actually really that funny. I loved working on it though.
Yeah.
Yeah. I miss working on Sergeant Frog. We did a lot of work on Sergeant Frog for a long time, and I would love to work on that show again. I was the lead recently in a show that I hope will continue called Dimension W. Did you have a chance to check that out?
Yeah, I watched that.
Yeah, I loved that. I loved being involved with that because that was the first time I've ever been involved in something that was really close to a broadcast dub, where we would record it not too long after it was released in Japan. So we didn't even know where the story was going. So I was trying to catch up and read as much manga as I could find to be as prepared as I could for the series. And that was a really fun challenge, and it worked out pretty well.
And do you watch much anime outside of the things that shows that you've been involved with?
The only time I watch anime these days is to either prep for a role that I'm playing or to prep for a show that I'm directing. Other than that, I don't watch anime. It's not that I don't like it, it's just I do so much of it during the day.
Yeah.
It's the, it'd be like if you worked at a seafood restaurant, you wouldn't come home and just eat fish all the time. When I come home, if I do anything, I play with my kids, because I got a 5-year-old and a 1.5-year-old, who I'll be soon introducing to anime, probably starting with Sergeant Frog, by the way. I either play with them, or when I do get free time, I either try and play a video game, or I make music, or I do something creative, because I do anime all day, almost every day.
Yeah. We do have a couple of fan questions that we've put in here. So one of them, Adam Grand, wants to know if you ever expected Dragon Ball Z to take off like it did, and how do you feel being such an integral part of the English version?
Oh, yeah. When I first worked on Dragon Ball Z, when I first, was cast as Vegeta and Piccolo, Yamcha, I had no idea that Dragon Ball Z was going to be popular. Because back when I started, there wasn't really an internet to speak of.
Yeah.
There was sort of an internet, but it was the
back when GeoCity pages.
Yeah, exactly. There was no Wikipedia. There weren't fan subs online. There weren't fan message boards. There was no YouTube. If you wanted to download a photo, you could let it download overnight and it would maybe be there in the morning. It just wasn't, it wasn't the resource that it is now. So I didn't know how popular Dragon Ball Z was back then. To me, we were just working on a show and we were working really hard to try and get it on TV on time.
Yeah. What is the most awkward thing that you've had a fan ask you to say in Vegeta's voice?
Let's see. I have a lot of people asking me to say hi to their, say that I love their girlfriends, or Vegeta loves their significant other. Let's see, what else have people asked me before? One person asked me to do a plug for their online store, and it ended up being when I said, okay, sure, yeah, no problem, I don't mind doing that, whatever. Ended up being a store that sold adult novelties for bedroom activities, which is wasn't something that I would imagine Vegeta would ever be promoting, really.
Yep. And what we were hoping to do, we have a couple of phone numbers of fans.
Oh yes.
Big, big Dragon Ball fans. So we thought that we would try to prank call, surprise them as Vegeta. So,
this first fan
who's this? Is Shelby.
Okay.
So, all
right, Shelby.
You can hear over the phone.
Hello?
Shelby!
Hello?
Shelby, this is Vegeta, Prince of All Saiyans. Hi! I'm on the internet!
Do they have internet?
In space? Of course they do! How do you think I can take those 45-day long trips in my space pod? I've gotta have my YouTubes.
So have
Well, yes, of course. And what's great is that you only have to pay for a day of service.
God, I wish I had that.
So I'm calling you to say hi.
That's awesome.
Oh, and...
Do you guys, I don't even know what to say.
Oh, don't say anything at all. Say nothing, just listen to me talk. I'm just going to sing to you. La, 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 la. I took no singing lessons whatsoever.
Do you play any other instruments? Can you play the banjo or something?
I play the dead body.
Okay.
It's where you take a...
Question to ask a warrior?
Yes, you take a body, you take its head, and then you smash it. It's a beautiful sound. It sounds like...
Recently?
No, I haven't, but I'm about to. I know, because the same prince would technically not ever call you. He'd say,
yeah.
Hi, I have called you. I've done my duty. Goodbye.
So what else does the same prince get up to then?
Nothing! I sit in my room and I cry. And I wait for Bulma to come in. Wait, that sounds awkward. I think this conversation's getting out of control.
Always winning?
What? Did you just mention Kakarot's name?
Yeah.
Please do not say that name around me. Ever! Do you know what's weird about doing the voice of Vegeta? Is that everyone can hear you in the rooms around you, and they're probably really annoyed. So I gotta let you go.
Okay, have a good day.
Bye, Shelby. Oh, and if it's cool, I'm going to give everyone your phone number.
Only if they're saying.
Okay.
That's cool.
Stand by for her phone number. Goodbye. I love you. Don't tell Bulma.
I like your phone case.
Thank you.
That's adorable. Do you know what's really weird? Okay, hold on. Okay. Do you know I get that momentary sensation that I had lost, like that I didn't have my cell phone? Oh, that's like the scariest feeling. You're like,
yep.
Oh God, I'm missing something.
You just reminded me of one of my favorite Vegeta lines when he's fighting Nappa and... when you say, maybe you wouldn't be such a disappointment when you're dead.
That's a great thing to hear from a friend, you know what I mean? Like, that's what you said to me right before we got on this live stream today. You said, maybe you won't be such a disappointment today.
No.
You did, I remember you said it.
What's
my favorite Dragon Ball Z song?
Yeah.
I knew you were gonna ask that for some reason. I didn't just read it off your piece of paper.
Yeah.
My favorite Z saga, as far as, I have two sagas I really like. One's not really even hardly a saga, but Android Saga is my favorite because I love all of the characters that are introduced in the Android Saga. I love Trunks, I love Android 17, 18, I love Android 20. I love everything about that particular era. However, I think the series is best during what I would consider like the Majin Vegeta arc.
Yeah.
And everything Majin Vegeta to me is my favorite. I love the fight with Goku. I love just what Vegeta chooses to do. No spoilers, although you've had, 17 years to watch this show. I just think everything in that part of the series is awesome.
Yeah. And when you were working on the Battle of Gods, the Dragon Ball Z movies, especially the newer ones, there was one scene in particular that a lot of people have been talking about, and that's the bingo scene. And the change in sort of Vegeta's character, I guess, in the movies. And I was wondering, how do you feel about that change from, say, the older series?
I've had some people say, like, I wish they weren't making Vegeta sound such a good wuss lately. And I would disagree with that decision. I would disagree with their opinion because Vegeta's had so much time to be like an angry, hemorrhoid-ridden jerk. I think it's funny that they're taking this guy who's always so angry and they're putting him in these super awkward situations.
Yeah.
I love it. And the bingo song, I was terrified by when I heard, because when the movie came out in Japan,
there
was a delay, a pretty long one between the time Battle of Gods came out in Japan and when it was actually dubbed. And fans would come up to me at cons and say, Vegeta sings in the next movie. And I was the kind of guy that I wasn't going to seek it out on the internet. It was hard to find that movie even online until it was released or closer to when it was released. So I didn't know what the bingo song even sounded like other than people's descriptions of it. And I was terrified because Ryo Horikawa, the Japanese Vegeta, has this really high-pitched voice. Maybe you've ever, if you've ever listened to the Japanese, you know what I'm talking about. It sounds like this, like, and I was scared because he's also a thespian and a singer. I thought, there's no way I'm gonna be able to match the pitch of his Vegeta singing the song.
Opera training.
I know, but I know opera well enough to know that he would not be in the same register that I sing.
Yeah.
So I was terrified that it was gonna be out of key or something. It wasn't gonna be a key I could sing in. Turns out it was just something I could very easily perform, because I thought I was going to it. As soon as we got the materials, I had the engineers fast forward to that section in the movie. I was like, I've got to see what's going on. And then when I saw what it was, I felt a lot better, because I thought Vegeta probably didn't spend much time singing ever.
Yeah.
However, Vegeta's the type of person that if he's going to sing, he's going to be the best damn singer he can possibly be. So I was trying to do this mixture between him not being a very good singer, him singing the way he thinks he should sing, which would probably be just like shouting, and him just trying to be a better singer than Kakarot.
You actually did an amazing job, I thought.
I really appreciate it.
It's one of my favorite things
from the movie. Oh, I love that. That was one of my favorite parts. And I don't know if people have been watching... even though it's not really, you know, legal to do so, I'm sure that some people have been finding ways to watch Dragon Ball Super online. And while there's no official word as to when that's going to be coming out, I've seen little bits and pieces of what he's going through. I've also read the manga as far as I can read. So it gets into Japanese, and I don't read Japanese, but they are still doing this thing where they're putting Vegeta in little awkward moments. And I love it. I think it's funny. I think it's true to the spirit of what Akira Toriyama would have wanted to, because he just likes comedy. He likes to be goofy.
And there was a lot of that in sort of early Dragon Ball as well, I found.
Totally.
And the really awkward things, particularly Goku doing in the innocent scenarios. We have another fan question from Farah Partridge, who would like to know, who do you think would win in a fight between Vegeta and All Might?
Oh, wow. See, my heart's always with Vegeta in all cases because, you know, he is pretty amazing and spent a long time training.
Yeah.
He also could fight longer than 3 hours, so I think that's would easily... I mean, at least at this point in the series, not to spoil... Well, okay, you wouldn't even know what we're talking about, so I don't care if I spoil this a little bit. Vegeta can fight longer than 3 hours.
Yeah.
And All Might cannot.
Yes. And speaking of that, if you were in All Might's situation where you had to pick a successor, would you have picked Deku or would you have picked one of the other characters?
I think I would have picked Deku. I'm the type of person that likes to give people a shot. I like the idea that he saw somebody that just looked altruistic and genuine and gave him an opportunity. That's one of the coolest things that you can do if you have that sort of power. I mean, actually, I feel like that's the coolest thing about being the voice of Vegeta or working in Dragon Ball for this long. It's that I can sign something for somebody to make them so happy, or I can give you something to give to somebody to make you into a hero too. So that's like the coolest skill that you can have. Otherwise, I'd be having to help people like move from one house to another, and that's a pain in the butt.
If you could pick any quirk, if you could have any quirk in the world, what would you pick? And for those of you who haven't watched My Hero Academia, a quirk is sort of like a power.
My power would be to stop time, because I never feel like I have enough of it. So Groundhog Day with Bill Murray, it's a classic film that some of you may have watched or some of you have no idea what I'm talking about, but it's literally about a dude whose day stops time every day at the same time. He has to keep reliving the same day until he gets it perfect. God, I wish I could do that every now and then just to practice some things I wanted to practice and learn a new language or learn a new instrument, because I hate doing things in incremental steps. Like, I hate just having to notch away at something every day. I'm more of I want to get it all done at once. And so, it just doesn't work that way.
Here's an interesting question for you. Who do you think is a better dad in Dragon Ball Z, Goku or Vegeta?
Piccolo is the best dad in Dragon Ball Z.
I would agree with that.
Yeah. Okay, but of the two, Vegeta is a far better father, I think, because Vegeta actually acknowledges his children, even if he says, you know, even if he's not incredibly nice to them all the time, he at least acknowledges them.
Yeah.
Or him. Goku will be gone for who knows how long, and then just show up again after months of being gone and doesn't even acknowledge Gohan's existence. Just like, I think he acknowledges Krillin before he acknowledges Gohan. And I think that's just because Goku is not real. That's what I love about Vegeta over Goku. I think Vegeta is a stronger character in general because Vegeta chose, whoops, is that my phone? Vegeta chose to be a good person.
Yeah.
Whereas Goku smacked his head and became a good person. So I feel like Vegeta had to earn his place to be in the kind of the hero squad, whereas Goku just like, I don't know, he just like fell on his head. He's a dude with a head injury, that's it.
Yeah.
And I also feel that I've been understanding Goku's character more and more the more we work on it. And the more I understand about Goku, the more I actually realize that he's a very selfish character. Like he will put his friends in grave danger just to, you know, just to fight somebody a little bit stronger. Now I know Vegeta's guilty of that too, but Goku's only interest in fighting is really just to see if he can fight someone who's really strong. I don't think he is the altruistic hero that we as like in our Western culture want to believe he is. He's not Superman. He's not fighting for justice necessarily. He's just fighting just for the sake of getting like almost a fight boner every time he wants to meet somebody. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And we've got some different kind of questions. Before I get to them though, have you ever cosplayed?
Have I ever cosplayed? The only time I've cosplayed is that sometimes I will get like, I will find a mask or a cosplay at a convention so that I can walk around the dealer hall without having to, if I only have a limited amount of time and I need to find stuff in the dealer room, I'll put on like a mask or something so that people won't know who I am.
What kind of mask?
I found that, I think it's from, who's that, the guy with the orange, I've never watched his show, but it's like an orange mask that looks like it's almost wood grain. It's like, I think it might be from Naruto, maybe.
Has it got an eye hole? Obito?
You would know more than I would. It's like an orange mask with like black lines that run through it. Yeah, I think you were right. People are going,
maybe.
You're right.
Right? Yeah!
Yay. And the only other time I've cosplayed was at a convention in Montreal. No, not Montreal. It was Winnipeg, Canada. Yeah. And it was when Monica Rial and some people, Monica's the voice of Bulma on Dragon Ball Z. She's the voice of a lot of things on a lot of anime. She was also, I think, Stocking and Panty and Stocking. Anyway, she was on a panel and I wanted to mess with her, so I dressed up in this cosplay that somebody gave me. It was like a Kirigumi or whatever. And I put like this gas mask on and put it on way over my face, and I waited to ask a question during her panel. I'm like, it's my birthday, and I was wondering if I could get a hug. And she's like, sure, come out and get a hug. So I went up on stage and I stood up on the couch next to her and I started like dry humping her shoulder sort of, and it was becoming super awkward for her. And then she found that was me and it was all fine.
Have you done many sort of pranks or things to
I've done so like, many pranks.
What's
so
your
many,
best one? Or the
There's a long-winded prank, and you'll just have to look it up on the internet, about a kazoo and Sean Schemmel. That was like the longest haul prank I've ever done. But another great prank I played was on Ian Sinclair, the voice of Space Dandy.
Yeah.
One time, one of my fellow actors, like Brina Palencia, she and I went to a store and bought a bunch of women's clothes and products and toiletries and things like that. And we got the convention people to give us a key to his room. I don't know why they agreed, but we got a key to his bedroom. And while he was out, we went into his room, packed up all his clothes, packed up all of his things, put it in his suitcase, hid it behind like a curtain in his room, and then took all of these women's clothes and other products and decorated his room to look like somebody else was staying there. So when he came in at the end of the night after a long night of drinking, that he would be really confused.
That would be really confusing. Yeah.
And according to Ian, he walked in and he was very confused, but he was just standing there going like, I know this is my room. I'm positive this is my room. Then he goes, Chris Sabat's on this convention with me. I know what's going on. So.
You've also voiced one of the lead parts in Ninja Slayer, which really surprised me. What was it like to work on that show compared to some of the others?
Ninja Slayer was crazy because that show was coming out on a week-by-week basis, too, and we had no idea where that show was going. I'm glad you mentioned that, too. And I wonder if Ninja Slayer, how well Ninja Slayer is doing in Australia versus how well it did in America, because it was a show that wasn't really heavily publicized in America. I don't think most people even know about it. But if you're one of these types of people, and you're the type of, well, I don't know, if you're one of these types of people, you're just now waking up, but one of these type of people that stay up really late, hang out with your friends and doing stuff, it is the perfect show to watch. It's totally non sequitur. It's about this guy called Ninja Slayer, and it's the most ridiculous show I've ever seen. On the one hand, it looks like it should be this really kick-ass show about a dude who like hunts down ninjas, but then when they get into a fight, they'll stand there and then the characters will lift up like paper dolls and then just hit each other's feet like this until Ninja Slayer always wins and the enemy explodes with real fire.
Yeah.
There's a hashtag that we were using because there's a quote that he says all the time. It's like, yard! It's Yart, Y-E-E-E-A-R-T, and he says it every time he fights. In fact, we do a lot of copying and pasting of the same fight sounds over and over and over and over again. Just watch one episode of it, and you'll be confused enough to want to watch the rest of it.
Yeah, I've been talking to people about the show as well, and what you said is exactly how I've been recommending it. Sort of the late night show that you watch from your
friends. It looks like something that would have been on like Toonami or Adult Swim. You had Toonami out here, sort of, right?
We know it.
It's you're familiar with what Toonami was in America. That those types of shows in the mid to late 90s is what it looks like. It looks like it almost looks like kind of Aeon Flux mixed with Powerpuff Girls, kind of in the most horrible way. It's terrible.
And because you voice Armstrong in Fullmetal Alchemist, we had a fan question. Do you have any skills passed down through your family for generations?
Let's see. Well, we have the skill of getting lost no matter where we go, because I have zero sense of direction, like zero. I'm exactly like Zorro when it comes to finding places. Even if I have a GPS, I will still get lost. Like, I just cannot figure out where I'm going. I just don't know. I'm terrible. And if you ever play me in some sort of first-person shooter situation, I will always turn right when I get to any hallway and end up just running in circles.
What kind of games do you play at the moment? This
will be well, I get to play games so infrequently because most of the time I spend with my kids. Yeah. When I do get to play it, I sometimes get to play mostly on conventions, and I played a lot at night, especially in the down days that we had between Sydney and Perth. I finally got to crack open a game I've had for months now, and it was the Phantom Pain. It's the Metal Gear Solid game. And it's a really long-winded intro, but I love sneaking games. I like games that take you a long time and you have to sneak really fast, because that's where, I think that's the only thing I can win. It's like this game I wanted to invent called Patience for the Wii, where grandparents could actually play their grandkids who only want to play like first-person shooters because they have really crazy reflexes and stuff like that.
Yeah.
This would be a game where you just have to sit there for a very long time and wait for something to happen, and that's a skill that only old people have.
Yeah.
And so now I feel like I can't play first-person shooters without getting my ass handed to me regularly. So I don't know. I prefer games I can take my time, sneak around it.
Patience.
Yeah.
We might do a giveaway now. So what we're gonna do? We have this Super Saiyan God double pack, which contains Battle of Gods and Resurrection F, and we're going to give you a code word. So while we do that, we might answer some of the questions that have been in the stream. But did you want to tell people what the code word is?
Yes, I think, let's say, how about we do, just we were talking about earlier, how about bingo? B-I-N-G-O.
Whoops. So comment bingo, and we'll select a winner shortly, and then we will, well, I won't, but Chris
should it be, is it hashtag bingo, or is it just bingo?
Just bingo.
Okay.
Just write bingo as many times as you want in the stream. So we have some of these fan questions from the stream.
Oh, wow. He has the worst handwriting, doesn't he?
How?
Scribble, 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 sorry. Scribble. How do you handle voicing most badass character ever? Well, that just comes naturally. No, in order to voice Vegeta, I have to get a lot of sleep the night before. I can't go out too heavily the night before. I've got to be in really in pretty good physical condition to do his voice, because even after, you know, 4 hours or so of doing it, I feel like I've got a flu sometimes. And then the next one says, how was playing Zoro? Great. He's awesome. He has three swords. Do you beat up the voice of Goku? Yes, I do. On a regular basis. You could ask Sean, who plays Goku, that I beat him up regularly. Have you met Japanese voice cast of Dragon Ball Z? Yes, I have. Not all of them, but I met the voice of Piccolo, and I met the voice of Vegeta many, many, many times. His name is Ryo Horikawa. I mentioned him earlier. Mm. I've actually been to Japan and did a workshop at his studio, because he has a, he's an instructor at a voice acting school in Japan.
Wow.
So I went over there to do a class on American dubbing, and it was great.
Do you understand much Japanese?
I understand no Japanese at
all. Is it hard to sort of talk when you meet the Japanese cast?
Well, the cool thing is like, Ryo speaks pretty good English. English is pretty good. It's infinitely better than my Japanese, since I speak none of it. And there's usually a translator. The only thing that's embarrassing for me sometimes is I find that I feel like I do this instinctively, whereas I would normally speak a little faster. When I talk to Japanese people, I tend to speak like I am doing some sort of text-to-speech program. And I find myself instinctively slowing down so they can understand everything. Let's see, have you, that's already did that one.
Does that say chocolate?
It says five chocolate, it says five chocolate.
Do you want to help us out?
Do you know what it says? No, it says, I think it's like favorite character design. Yeah. Let's see. I love Gardevoir's character design. I think he's neat. But my favorite, and I hate to say this, I'm not being paid to say this at all, but the character designs in My Hero Academia are probably my favorite I've seen in a long time. Like Deku is the main boy character, he's like the kid character. He's got these huge eyeballs and he's really, really adorable. And I love All Might's character. I like both forms of All Might. I think that's really one of the neatest shows I've seen lately. I'll be surprised if that show doesn't do really well.
What's it like, because you sort of All Might when he's all quirked up, and then you also All Might when he's frail, and
the way,
is it hard to do the two different voices?
Well, All Might is the voice when he's in his hero mode, is where I'm really putting on a voice. Gosh, it's early in the morning for me, sort of. I feel like it's early. I've been kind of still jet lagged, but I am here is the kind of the voice I use for him. He's this typical hero voice. And when he's not All Might, when he's just kind of like, when he's not in his hero form, he's just kind of his weak form, I just try and play him as naturally as I can, because that's him without really having to put any like effort into his speaking voice at all.
One of the things I really love about All Might is his laugh.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry. My voice is really jacked up today. I don't know why. Like, my voice is really hoarse. I apologize.
What's it like making the noise when the blood splatter comes out, you know, and stuff
like that's my favorite part, actually, because, you know, we dubbed this from Japanese into English, so you have to be talking at the same time. So I love being able to talk, knowing what my line is, and watching the screen to be sure I'm talking and I'm saying something at the same time. And like, I love having to cut myself off to do the nasty blood sounds.
Yeah.
Nasty blood sounds.
I don't think there's any way I would ever be able to do that.
Is anybody, did anyone win that thing yet?
Yes. So congratulations to Tom Reynolds.
Thom. T-H-O-M.
I'm
going to sign this to you, Thom, T-H-O-M.
And
I'm also going to, I'm also going to lick one of the discs. Hold on. There you go. And then I'll put this disc under my underarm here. So you have all my DNA now. In case something happens to me, you can recreate me with the power of science. Hold on a minute. Oh, I've jacked it up. Sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah. I'm just kidding. Oh yeah. Okay. T-H-O-M.
Yeah. And we'll be sending that to you once we get back to Melbourne.
I'm gonna say, Tom, great to meet you. Although he's never met me, but that's okay. Tom, you're welcome to say that you did meet me virtually on the internet. Oh, that sounds creepy too. And I'm gonna also write bingo on it.
He could also lick the disc.
Yeah, ooh. then we would have made out. Like,
I'm sorry, that was a horrible thing to say.
No, that's okay. You may lick this disc, Tom. This is yours to lick. I'm sorry, I'm a terrible human being.
We're probably running out of time, so I'd like to thank you
so much. I'd also like to draw a mustache on you with this permanent marker. No, I can't do that.
No, seriously, do it.
Can I do it?
I let Bryce and Trina put Vegemite on my face.
Yeah, but this, you'll be scrubbing your face for a long time. Okay.
Let's do it.
Okay, all right. Let's do this. Here we go. All right. I'll just do it lightly here.
I thought you were going to do a curly one.
Oh, no. I wanted this to be sort of pencil thin action. I am so sorry for how long.
Do you want to do a goatee as well?
Oh, I think this is going to be great. Hold on, I'm going to just do...
The sad thing is I've drawn a beard on my face before.
With permanent marker. Okay, that's good. There you go. I'm just kind of giving you this sort of Napa look.
Making me look super hot.
Yeah, it's sort of this wrestler kind of thing. Oh, yeah. Oh, that is amazing. Hold on. I need a picture of that. Can we just, hold on. Let's do this. By the way, I just looked on my phone and they're like, where are you? Oh, dude, that is mean. Oh, that's good. Hold on, we'll do it up here. I'm trying to find where the light's not screwing me up. Oh, there you go. Oh, God, that's intense.
And you can follow Christopher on Twitter.
Look at you now.
Voice of Vegeta. That's awesome. Voice of Vegeta.
I'm Voice of it. Yeah.
Do you have any other social media channels?
No, that's the best one to follow me at. At Voice of Vegeta. Look at this graphic right here.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you everyone for joining the stream. Hope you had a good time, and congratulations, Tom.
I love you, Mad Men.
Goodbye.
Oh, and women, mad women too.